Okay, welcome. We're going to get started with our second master's level 3-minute thesis competition. Okay, on behalf of our presenters and the College of Graduate Studies, I thank you for coming out and showing your support. If you have never been to a 3MT competition before, I think you're in for a very, very special treat. Have you ever tried to read a research article, right, written for an academic discipline other than your own? Or maybe from a subfield of your own discipline that you're really unfamiliar with? Because of the amount of jargon and terminology used specifically within that discipline, you're likely to read one paragraph and just simply ask, "What did I read?" So while command of such language is important within specific disciplines, it is lost on the vast majority of potential consumers of such work. The presenters you will hear tonight will attempt to bridge the gap between research and consumerism. They will attempt to transport you into their passion for research in a language we can all understand. Okay, the 3-minute thesis is a research communication competition developed by the University of Queensland. The competition develops academic presentation and research communication skills and supports the development of students' capacities to effectively explain their research in language appropriate to an intelligent but non-specialist audience. That's you guys over there. Okay. Graduate students have 3 minutes to present a compelling discussion on their research topic, its significance and relevance to the general public. The 3-minute thesis is not an exercise in trivializing or dumbing down research, but forces competitors to consolidate their ideas and crystallize their research discoveries. It is a celebration of the discoveries made by graduate students and will allow the broader community to learn about ongoing research at Texas A&M University, Corpus Christi. Before we get started, I would like to thank Professor Don Luna for his continued assistance with preparing students for this event. Don has attended workshops at the Alan Aldiss Center for Communicating Science at Stony Brook College. He uses training to assist both students and faculty to tell the story of their research. At this time, I'd like to introduce the founding dean of the College of Graduate Studies, Joanne Canales, who will bring greetings from the College of Graduate Studies.
Really, this is so wonderful to see so many people at this event, and we're delighted that we have graduate students who are willing to go out on that thin limb over a raging river, but there's a fish in there, so you'll be fine, to do this. This is really an important exercise and skill for our students. So a couple of years ago, I had an opportunity, along with other graduate deans from across the country, to visit with the staffers of those congressmen in Washington who fund STEM projects and fund STEM research. And they were very candid about how they go about deciding what they're going to fund. So they mine theses and dissertations across the country and look to see what people are doing, what people are interested in, what kind of output there is, and what the broader impact of all of that is. And they, of course, are young staffers. They're not STEM or humanities trained necessarily. And so what they said is that they look at the abstracts. And if they can't understand what the research is about, it goes out the window. So can you imagine what a travesty that is with all the hard work that's invested by our students across the country in doing wonderful things, but because they don't know how to communicate it in layman's terms, they may lose out on a tremendous opportunity for added funding for research. So I commend and applaud those of you who are doing this tonight, and those of you out in the audience, I encourage you to join us next year for this event as well, and to always think about being able to communicate the great work that you do in layman's terms so that others can see the wonderful work that you're doing. Thank you for joining us.
Next up, I'd like to introduce the Vice President for Research and Commercialization and Outreach, Dr. Luis Fuentes, who will say a few words regarding the importance of this event.
Good evening. President Ochoa and our Vice President for Student Engagement and Success, Dr. Don Albright, for being part of this. The other thing that has to be said is what Dr. Canales and Dr. Seidel have done to change the culture of graduate studies on this campus needs to be applauded. So please join me in thanking the work that they've done. How many of you know that we are in what's called the post-expert digital age? You're looking at somebody who grew up in the black and white television. So we are way beyond that. In a recent article, and those of you who are geoscientists should probably know this publication, American Geophysical Union, Amy Lors and David Kunstner wrote, "The biggest challenge of the digital age for science communication, or any research communication, is the shift from the broadcast model, where a network or magazine broadcast information," think about Walter Cronkite. Walter Cronkite spoke, everybody trusted what was said, "to now a conversation model where someone generates information and others comment, share, or if you watch CNN or Fox News, scream at each other." What's happening in this post-digital age is that the notion of the expert, you, who are getting master's degrees or doctoral degrees, is being diluted. And you're seeing this. What you're seeing on television is somebody who knows absolutely nothing about your field getting up there and contradicting somebody who is an expert in the field. That would not have happened in my generation. So you, who are going to be the professionals of the next generation, have to learn how to communicate in a different way. We grew up being told you have to learn how to be a public speaker, which is the process of speaking to a group of people in a structured, deliberate manner intended to inform, influence, and entertain listeners. You're falling asleep just listening to me describe it. That's what we did. We would do that in front of people most of the time in our own discipline. So if we were nervous, it was because there might be somebody in the audience who is a Nobel Prize winner or a true expert in the field who might catch a mistake or something that we said that wasn't that compelling. You guys are now having a conversation, even if there isn't somebody out there. And the thing that makes this conversation interesting is that the person on the other side may not have any knowledge of your discipline, but is going to feel very confident in speaking up and contradicting you whether or not they know anything about it. So that means that you have to gain a completely different skill set than my generation did when you communicate what you do. And if there are two things I will tell you to do, and believe me, it's not easy, whatever you do, be confident. Even if you're not totally confident in what you're doing, when you get up, you absolutely have to be confident. And the other thing is, do not fear being passionate about what you do. Because if anything is compelling, it is the passion of youth learning about something new. Good luck.
Favor. I bet everyone in this room has something that looks like this, yes? Would you take it out for just a second? The teacher in me coming out, in case you haven't guessed that. Got it? You see that little switch where it says silence the ring? Please do that. At the regional competition, we asked for the silencing. Someone did. And it went off right in the middle of someone's talk. And we don't want our students to go through that tonight. So please make sure that your phones are either silent or off. Okay?
All right, so now it's time to meet our judges. And just let me say, I think we have outdone ourselves this time. Okay, so first up, I want to talk about Dr. Don Albright, our Vice President for Student Engagement and Success. Dr. Don Albright has served as Vice President for Student Engagement and Success at Texas A&M University Corpus Christi since July 2012. Prior to coming to the Island University, he worked at West Texas A&M University, Baylor University, and Texas A&M University. Albright graduated from Texas A&M University with a Bachelor in Business Administration degree in marketing. He earned his Master of Education degree and was awarded the Doctor of Philosophy degree in Educational Administration, also from Texas A&M University. Albright is originally from Rosenberg, Texas. He's married and has two daughters, one son, one grandson, and one granddaughter. I wonder you're smiling. fun fact, he has a set of male-female twins, both working in higher education. His son works at Texas State, daughter works at Florida State. Okay? So please welcome Don Albright. Next up, we have Susan Ochoa-Spiri. Susan is originally from Corpus Christi, Texas, and is actively working with the Innovation Center at TAMU CC campus and the Engineering Department at TAMU Kingsville campus for the past years. Susan obtained her Juris Doctor from Williams Mitchell College of Law in St. Paul, Minnesota, and previously earned a BS in chemistry from the University of Texas at San Antonio. She has been a registered patent attorney since 1990 and in private practice since 2009. And so I understand it, she loves private practice. She worked with the Exxon Corporation in Baytown, Texas from 1991 to 1995, and with the Celanese Corporation from 1995 to 2009. In both companies, she served as in-house counsel in the IP area, working in all facets of procurement and enforcement of patents, trademarks, and copyright, and in preparing, reviewing, and negotiating the technical directed art agreements surrounding these areas. Susan also worked on various mergers and acquisitions during her employment with these corporations. Besides helping entrepreneurs and inventors obtain patent and other protection for new processes, ideas, machines, and products, Susan is a member of the Corpus Christi Bar Association, the State Bar of Texas, Grievance Committee, and the Communities and Schools Board of Directors. Susan's fun fact is that she has been in a domino group with the same three other women for the past 5 years and recently added poker to the games. Unfortunately, however, she admits to being a very bad poker player, and I'm not sure if that's setting us up or should we invite her to our games. Let's give a round of applause for her. Steve. Last but not least, we have Karen O'Connor Urban. I'm sorry. Not good with balancing these two. Sorry. Okay. Last but not least, Karen O'Connor Urban. Okay. Karen is a native of Pennsylvania and resides in Corpus Christi, Texas. She received her undergraduate degree from the University of Pennsylvania, a Bachelor's of Science in Dental Hygiene from Columbia University, and her Master's of Education from Fresno Pacific College. Karen has held various positions in teaching, in higher education, and leadership roles in administration. Her list of professional activities is law. Okay? Here are some of the highlights. She was a member of the Texas A&M University Foundation Board and co-chaired a $37 million capital campaign and was board president in 2013. She's a member of the Board of Governors and past chairman of the South Texas Institute for the Arts. She's a Junior League sustainer. She's a member of the Krista Spahn Foundation Board and the Krista Spahn System Board. She chaired the Cancer Center Renewal Project and completed the Healing Garden and was chair-elect of the Foundation Board ending in 2013. She's currently serving on the Krista Spahn Finance and Strategy Committee. She's a member of the Advisory Board of American Bank, Corpus Christi. She's a member of the Ronald McDonald House Founding Board. She's a member of the Mayo Clinic Cancer Leadership Council in Rochester, Minnesota. She's a member of the American College Medical Genetics Foundation Board. She's a member of the Coastal Bend Community Foundation Board. And just one more, she's an active volunteer with Mission of Mercy. Obviously, being an active community and civic volunteer is an integral part of her life. Karen is married to Larry Urban. And now, as a fun fact, Karen is, in, you know, sometimes in a bit of disguise, okay? Karen is also a clown, okay? As Miss Cookie, okay, Karen has been part of the Clowns Who Care since their foundation in 1993, ministering to the children of Bristol Children's Hospital, okay? And she sent me the slide, and I just have to show this to you, okay? I think if we catch her later tonight, we might actually be able to find out the story behind this one. Okay. But yeah, let's please welcome Karen O'Connor. Set the ground rules for how this is going to work. So the three-minute thesis, master's level competition celebrates the exciting research conducted by master's level graduate students. Developed by the University of Queensland, the exercise cultivates students' academic presentation and research communication skills. The competition supports their capacity to effectively explain their research in 3 minutes in a language appropriate to that non-specialist audience. Eligibility and rules, students that are competing here must be current enrolled master's students at TAMU-CC. They must be engaged in a research or thesis study as principal investigator. They need to have approval from their thesis chair or research advisor, and the data must be collected for the presented research prior to the competition. Okay. Our rules for 3MT, a single static PowerPoint slide is allowed. No more. Just one. Can't do any of that fancy PowerPoint stuff that you're seeing in my transitions and things. The slide is to be presented from the beginning of the oration. There's no additional electronic media, sound, video files that are permitted. No additional props, so no costumes, no musical instruments, laboratory equipment are permitted. Presentations are limited to 3 minutes maximum, and the competitors exceeding 3 minutes are disqualified. Presentations are to be spoken words, so no poems, no rapping, okay, no songs. Okay. Presentations are to commence from the stage. Presentations are considered to have commenced when the presenter starts their presentation through either movement or speech. The decision of the adjudicating panel is So the judges will be judging on a number of things. So they'll look at comprehension, which really are the key concepts and results presented in that talk. In terms of communication, did the presenter effectively convey information to a non-specialist audience? In terms of engagement, did the presenter keep the audience's attention? Were they passionate about the topic? So let's meet those competitors. I thought about making them run a long time and do it. And now! There we go. Maybe next time. Okay. So, our competitors today, we have six speakers. Haley Beck from the Marine Biology Program. Her advisor is John Scarpa. Okay. I'm going to call your name. Go ahead and stand up for everyone. Adam Bynum from the Marine Biology Program. His advisor is Chris Berg. Melody Gingras, okay, from Coastal Marine System Science. Her advisor is Jane Jabot.
She'll be right back.
Okay. All right. Get her. Shane Reeder, from Psychology. Welcome to Dr.
Thank you.
Next up, we have Shane Reeder from Psychology, advisor Miguel Moreno, talking about No Cakewalk, the bitter truth about dieting and food choices.
Study something that you like. That's what they tell you when you're starting a thesis, something that you like. Well, I like to eat, and I'm not the only one. I know that because I was watching the snack bar outside. In America, we love to eat. In fact, it's become something of a problem. In Texas, the adult obesity rate is more than 30%. We're trying to change that with education. We have large-scale campaigns to promote healthy eating decisions, but they're not working too well, and I wanted to know why that is. One of the contributing problems is that high-calorie, high-fat foods, what we call obesogenic foods, have a certain appeal. I wanted to start simple. I wanted to measure that gut feeling of satisfaction and tastiness that surrounds obesogenic foods. Piece of cake, right? Well, psychology wouldn't be very interesting or very accurate if we just asked people questions like, what kinds of foods do you enjoy? Instead, we use very special tools that allow us to measure not just what people think or what they do, but also how they feel about something. These are the ABCs of psychology. Affect, how we feel, behavior, what we do, and cognitions, what we think about something. And most of the time they get along. Sometimes, however, they may disagree. Smokers, for instance, may have unpleasant thoughts and feelings regarding cigarettes despite continuing to smoke. In the lab, we can measure affect using a psychological tool called the implicit association test. We can measure behavior using weight status, and we can measure cognitions using that simple survey asking, what kinds of foods do you enjoy? Well, we like rich, delicious, obesogenic foods, right? That's the whole point of the study. So you can imagine our surprise when, in fact, participants demonstrated very strong, unpleasant attitudes and feelings towards obesogenic foods. That couldn't be right. So we did it again with more participants, with different versions of the tests. We compared these feelings to real food choices in the lab, and each time we got the same result. Participants held unpleasant feelings towards obesogenic foods regardless of what they actually ate. Well, that left us in a real pickle. Why is it that we continue to consume obesogenic foods despite these secret, unsavory attitudes? Well, this is the same pattern that we see with addictive behavior, such as smoking cigarettes and alcoholism, suggesting that over-consuming obesogenic foods is a variety of addiction. This might also explain why the American obesity rate continues to rise despite the best efforts of these health and nutrition campaigns. These campaigns are trying to change our behavior by changing our affect and cognition regarding obesogenic foods. And by some measures, they've worked. The attitudes are in the right place. The knowledge is in the right place. These factors just don't actually change behavior. So when we see each other at the snack bar later, and don't worry, I'll be there too, we can ask ourselves, are we making these choices with our brains or with our bellies? Thank you.
Next up, we have Alex Tompkins from the Marine Biology Program, advisor Greg Stuntz, here to talk about saving red snapper one drop at a time.
I want everybody to imagine you just let go of a balloon. If you could follow that balloon into the sky, you'll notice the gases inside of it expanding as the atmospheric pressure decreases. Now I want you to imagine you're fishing for red snapper in 200 feet of water offshore. When you bring a fish from the bottom to the surface, the gases inside of its swim bladder, the organ that's responsible for regulating buoyancy, expand just like the gases in the balloon. The same processes occurring in that balloon occur in deep water fish, and it presents some serious issues when trying to manage the most economically important fishery in the Gulf of Mexico, the red snapper fishery. They're the most highly targeted fish in the Gulf, but last year anglers only had 9 days to fish for them due to strict management efforts to rebuild the population. The result is an almost exclusively catch and release fishery. The issue here is, if you simply release a fish at the surface that you've just brought up from the deep, it'll simply float away and die. So we fix this with these new innovative tools called descender devices. We couple descender devices with a heavy weight, and we can descend that red snapper back to depth while recompressing all those gases in the swim bladder, allowing it to survive and swim away happy. My research is aimed at refining the best way to use these devices through tagging, releasing, and monitoring post-release survival in red snapper using a popular descender device, the sequelizer. My research has shown that fish descended with the sequelizer are 5 times more likely to survive than fish released at the surface. The results is anglers also perceive these as extremely beneficial. Using a survey I distributed to over 1,100 anglers who received the free sequelizer as part of my research, I found that 94% of those anglers believe these devices significantly increase survival through red snapper. By integrating these devices into the management of the fishery, we can rebuild the population much quicker, resulting in a larger quota and more than 9 days to fish. Red snapper are an extremely important fishery in the Gulf of Mexico. They boost our local economies, not only by bringing fish to consumers' tables, but by bringing tourist dollars that contribute to a booming $14 billion recreational fishing industry in the Gulf of Mexico. Nobody wants to see their precious resource floating away on the surface dead. We know how to fix this problem, so let's save the red snapper fishery one drop at a time. Thanks.
Next up, we have Claire Ridman from Environmental Science. Her advisor is James Jabot. She's here to talk about modeling barrier island morphodynamic responses to extreme storms.
I don't know about you, but I love going to the beach. For us Texans, the beaches we go to are on barrier island. These islands are very important coastal landscapes. They are the first line of defense when an extreme storm strikes the coast, protecting the mainland from the brunt of the storm. Without these islands, the impacts of these storms would be far worse. My research focuses on the processes and changes that occur when a barrier island and a storm meet. Background of my research involves studying the processes and changes that occur near the beach every day. Barrier islands are dynamic landscapes. They are slowly changing shape and moving with the rise and fall of the tide, an increase or decrease in global sea level, and of course from the effects of storms. Hurricane Ike is the most recent storm which struck our Texas coastline in 2008, killing 195 people. Property damages from the storm were estimated at $29 million. That's not the end of it. There is a lingering negative economic impact long after the storm, with estimates totaling $142 billion. The greatest threat of the storm is the storm surge. Storm surge is an increase in water level primarily caused by the approaching hurricane's winds pushing water towards the coast. Sand dunes act like a barrier protecting the island and any development inhabiting it. However, if these dunes aren't tall or wide enough, they can't keep the threat of the surge from pushing through. These dunes here were less than 7 feet tall before the storm. The maximum surge was recorded at 15 to 20 feet above the average tide. In my research, I'm using a computer model that can reproduce a storm and how it impacts the coast. And I'm using it to model how an enhanced dune would have lessened the destruction of Hurricane Ike. Dune enhancement is an engineering method used to protect coastal development and has the added benefit of keeping a barrier island healthy. We need to plan with storm protection solutions that not only benefit and protect the homeowners and business owners living on the island, but also the barrier island itself. Thank you.
Next up, we have Adam Bynum from the Marine Biology Program, advisor Chris Bird, talking about modeling genetic diversity in non-equilibrium scenarios.
Okay, so humans' favorite pastime probably is destroying the environment in one way or another. We either drive our Hummers over the dunes and run over the little dune mouse habitat, or what we study here with ocean right there is overfishing. And what happens in overfishing, we don't just remove individuals from a population and they get replenished by babies turning into adults, adults into more babies, but they actually, something more sinister is happening. And as we remove individuals from a population, be it fish or dune rats, we lose something called genetic diversity. And genetic diversity plays an extreme role in adaptation, and without it, populations can adapt and survive to a changing environment. And it's so simple because all genetic diversity is how much variation is within the DNA of a species. So conservation efforts have mostly been around the assumption of genetic equilibrium, which is just the DNA of a population doesn't change much from generation to generation. And why they assume that is because it allows us to make a lot of assumptions and it makes research real easy. Unfortunately, as we run over the dune mice or harvest more fish than we need, they're not exactly in genetic equilibrium, but something called genetic non-equilibrium. And we don't know how genetic diversity interacts at that point. And that's where I come to say today. I made a model of the Hawaiian Islands, and the reason I picked Hawaii is because my professor has a bunch of real data from there. And it's a perfect stepping stone model. And all a stepping stone model is a chain of stones or islands. In my case, there's eight. And our migrants are only allowed to go from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, and so on and so forth. They can't make the jump from 1 to 3. And what I'm doing is I'm changing three parameters, population size, so how many individuals, mutation rate, which is how much DNA changes, and then migration rate, which is how many individuals go from 1 to 2. And what this results in is a model that we can give to conservationists and fishery management in order to say, hey, what is actually happening to genetic diversity in this non-equilibrium scenario, instead of just assuming, hey, equilibrium is the best we got, and we can make an assumption, which lets us get an iffy measurement of genetic diversity. So instead, they can take my model and say, hey, my population has this mutation rate, this migration rate, and we have 10 sizes here, 10 sizes there, or 10 individuals here, 20 there, and they can change it however they want. Let's say they don't have eight Hawaiian Islands, they have 15 different deep sea populations, and then they can get a real accurate measurement of what genetic diversity actually is, which in the long run hopefully allows us to fish more and then conserve the populations that are actually most diverse, which will in the end allow them to survive past two generations in the future.
Canales, Melody Gingras from the Coastal Marine System Science Program. Her advisor is James Jabot.
Well, my slide looks a little bit different than it did on my computer, but I'll be talking to you today about my thesis work, which is small-scale morphodynamics of maintained and unmaintained beaches on Mustang Island, Texas. So what I mean by morphodynamics is just the hydrologic processes, so winds, waves, and currents that shape the beach. So if you take nothing away, you learned a cool word that you can use with your friends, right? So what my research looked at is I had a maintained beach and I had an unmaintained beach, and I was trying to look at how the shape of the beach was different on each of the sites. So you can see up here, the shapes of the beaches are different, right? This on the left-hand side is an unmaintained beach, and on the right-hand side is a maintained beach. You have a lot more vegetation on an unmaintained beach, which is important because it anchors our dunes in place, which, as Claire was mentioning before, our dunes are very important when we have a storm event, right? So we want a lot of vegetation to keep our dunes in place because, of course, we don't want our houses flooded. The other issue is, and this is I guess, a huge scientific discovery, that if you push sand using a bulldozer off of the driving lane, that lowers the elevation of the driving lane. And then when you bury the vegetation, when vegetation is not exposed to sunlight, it dies, right? Really profound results here. So when you don't have that vegetation holding the dune in place, of course that makes us more vulnerable to coastal flooding during storm events, but there also is another issue with nuisance flooding. So that's what this image is right here. This is taken from Packery Channel, and when the water levels are increasing, I work in a lab where we're looking at sea level rise. That is a real thing, so this is only going to get worse, and maybe you can see, maybe you can't, but I can tell you from my study that the area that's flooded is where we do maintenance, so it's where we're lowering the elevation. So the reason that we do maintenance on the beach is so that we can access the beach. It's a part of the Texas Open Beaches Act, which was enacted in 1959, and I don't know about you, but I have a Honda Fit, and with 1 to 3 feet of water, I can't access the beach. So we need to probably think about maybe a different way that we could be doing maintenance in order to have a little bit more of a sustainable beach to keep driving on. Thank you.
Okay, to get started with the awards, what I want to do is offer certificates for everybody that presented tonight. I think all of us would agree. It takes some guts, okay, to get up and talk without the notes. I mean, I have notes up here, and I can't even follow my slide. So, what I'm going to do, I'm going to call your name as far as the speakers. What I want you to do, come up, start lining up on the far end. But I want you to stay up here until all of you are here, because I do want to get a nice photo op with all the speakers up front. So, first off, before we do, I want to call up Dean Canales and Luisa Fuentes to assist in the awards. Okay, so our first certificate goes to Shane Reeder. Thank you. Melanie Gingras. Claire Ridman. Alex Tompkins. Our second place finisher. Pause for dramatic effect. Yeah, I really do. Alex Tompkins.
Thank you.
thank you again for coming out to support our student presenters. I'd like to thank the College of Graduate Studies staff, along with the staff from the Heart Research Institute, who have helped out with this event. I would like to thank Dr. Luis Cifuentes, Vice President for Research, Commercialization, and Outreach, for his continued support of this event. It really just wouldn't be 3MT without him. He's been for everyone, and just been so grateful and helpful for our events. I would like to ask for my special thanks to our judges, Dr. Don Albright, Vice President of Student Engagement and Success, Susan Ochoa-Spiri, and Karen O'Connor Urban. We hope that this experience has been entertaining, just as entertaining as it has been educational for you. Finally, I'd like to especially thank Dean Joanne Canales, the founding dean of the College of Graduate Studies, for providing me with the opportunity and partnership to bring the 3-minute thesis competition to TAMU-CC. I hope that the presentations that you have heard tonight have inspired you to consider the importance of consumable communication in the advancement of science, and have encouraged you to compete in future 3MT events, or at least consider the importance of a future graduate education. Okay? Have a wonderful evening, and good night.